Now we're going to focus on Canada Deposit Insurance Corporation, which provides insurance to deposit-taking financial institutions in Canada.
CDIC insures deposits in Canadian currency in Canada. It does not insure foreign currency deposits. Insurable deposits include your checking accounts, saving accounts, term deposits with maturity of less than 5 years, money orders, drafts, certified drafts, and checks. It does not insure treasury bills, corporate bonds, investment in stocks, mutual funds, or mortgages. The rationale behind CDIC is that it's protecting your depositors against bank insolvencies and bank panics. It also promotes competition in your financial markets and financial institutions by allowing new and smaller banks to attract depositors. In the absence of deposit insurance, depositors would not keep deposits with small banks. They would only want to keep deposits at large banks or too big to fail institutions, as they don't have enough information to evaluate the risk profile of a new or a smaller bank. This creates a disadvantage for new banks and prevents their entry into the market. With deposit insurance, CDIC is actually removing this barrier to entry for new financial institutions. CDIC used to have a flat premium rate for all deposit-taking institutions. However, in May 1999, CDIC premiums were tied to the risk profile of the financial institutions. So, for example, if you're a high-risk bank, you would be paying a higher premium. If you're a low-risk bank, you will be paying a much lower premium on all your insured deposits. The risk profile of financial institution depends upon various factors. However, the most important of these is your capital adequacy requirement. If a bank does not have adequate amounts of capital, it will have prompt corrective action from CDIC, and CDIC will step in and will ask the bank to fulfill additional regulatory requirements. This table over here is showing us the four main categories in which banks are classified into depending upon their risk profile. Category 1 banks are the ones which are classified as your best bank, and these are the ones which are well capitalized. These best banks are paying the lowest premium of about 6.5 cents per $100. Category 4 banks are classified as the worst banks, and these banks are paying the highest premium, 33.3 cents per $100 of deposits. These, of course, are the banks which are severely undercapitalized. As soon as a bank does not have enough cushion of capital, so classified as your category 4, we see CDIC stepping in and taking prompt corrective action. Prompt corrective action requires the troubled bank to submit capital restoration plan. CDIC restricts their asset growth. CDIC also now requires the bank to seek regulatory approval to open any new branches or develop new lines of businesses. The good thing is that over 90% of CDIC members are classified as category 1 or category 2 in Canada. We do not have enough information about banks in other jurisdictions like USA or Europe, because not all countries and regulatory bodies reveal this information. A bylaw in 1999 allowed banks to opt out of deposit insurance. Now, opting out is not permissible for just any bank. It's only permissible for Schedule 3 banks to opt out of bylaw insurance. Schedule 3 banks are banks that primarily accept wholesale deposits, that is, deposits of more than $150,000. An opted out bank must inform all of its depositors that their deposits are now no longer insured by CDIC. Now, opting out might seem like a bad thing initially because deposits are now no longer insured in the event of bank failure. However, recall, when there is no deposit insurance, it actually creates a bigger incentive for depositors to enforce market discipline by withdrawing their deposits from the bank if they feel that the bank is taking on too much risk. Therefore, we see that as uninsured depositors are increasing their monitoring of the bank, it will actually reduce the risk-taking activities of these banks, thereby reducing the moral hazard risk. That brings us to the end of this chapter. Overall, we have learned in this chapter that regulatory framework is a constant work in progress. Regulators are always trying to identify the information gaps that we have in our system and then developing regulations that will address those information gaps. Our main regulatory bodies in Canada are the Bank of Canada, the Office of the Superintendent of Financial Institutions, OSFI, and the Canada Deposit Insurance Corporation. Most of the developments in the regulatory framework appear to be an important step in the right direction, because they increase the incentives for banks to hold capital and decrease their incentives to take on excessive risk. However, there's always some room for improvement, and regulators can always do a bit more to improve the incentives for banks to limit their risk taking. Some people also propose that deposit insurance and too big to fail policies should be completely eliminated, as they increase all of these adverse selection and moral hazard problems that we talked about. However, doing that would be going too far, because these proposals will end up making our financial system highly unstable and very prone to bank panics and contagions. So that's all for today. I hope you enjoy this video. I'll see you guys next time.